After I finished recovering data from my 2-year-long storage nightmare at the end of 2017 with some amazing help from Synology, it was time to establish a more permanent infrastructure solution that met my storage needs. We've made some huge upgrades on my home network in speed, functionality, and storage capacity, and I've been super stoked to share them with you. Useful tech education and gaming nostalgia that won't put you to sleep. Get subscribed and turn on notifications so you won't miss the next guide. I'm EposVox, here to make tech easier and more fun, and I've officially moved my primary networking over to 10 gigabit. Affordably, too. Last year, Synology and WD sponsored some storage upgrades for me to set up a kick-ass DS916 Plus rig to get all of my work-related video storage in one place. This has been a huge part in my business stability in recent months. A bottleneck I kept running into, however, was gigabit file transfers to the NAS from my computer or solid-state drives and so on. With some of the high bitrate and DNX footage that I capture, it could take up to an hour to transfer a small amount of usable footage to the NAS. So when we planned for a long-term solution, I wanted to make the jump to 10 gigabit networking. I experimented with it back in 2015 when I made a video showing how you can set up point-to-point 10 gigabit between two computers, and I already had some SFP Plus network cards and cables, so I was ready to go, sort of. The focus of my upgrade was Synology's newer DS1817 Plus, an 8-bay NAS that can expand up to 18 total drives via two DX517 expansion units. For now, we just went with one expansion unit. You can get these NAS boxes in either 2GB or 8GB memory configurations and can expand the RAM up to 16GB, though I haven't seen a need for that on my end. A quad-core Intel Atom C2438 powers the rig, and which also features 4GB LAN ports on board, as well as 4 USB 3.0 ports for expansion, which I use a lot with external drives. The really clutch feature, however, is the x8 PCIe expansion slot, allowing for either a dual M.2 SSD adapter for SSD caching or a network card, such as this dual SFP Plus 10 gigabit card installed on mine. Installing an expansion card is simple. Unscrew the 6 screws in the back that secure the outer shroud, slide off the cover, and flip around to the side. Here, a basic plastic mechanism holds the PCIe card in place. Lift up on the plastic lever, install your expansion card, and slide the mechanism back down to secure your card. Reinstall the outer shroud, and you're done. The DS1817 Plus also features a Kensington lock and 2 eSATA ports for the expansion bays mentioned before. I chose the 10 gigabit NIC as I needed faster transfer speeds between the NAS and my PC during editing and when ingesting footage. I'd love a NAS like this where I could utilize both 10 gigabit networking as well as an M.2 SSD cache, but this is fine for now. For storage capacity, you could totally max this out with SSDs and fully saturate that 10 gigabit line, but capacity is far more important for me right now. Western Digital was amazing enough to send out 13 of their 6TB WD Red drives. I've used many different drives in my time, and WD Reds are always my preferred NAS drives, and I even use one regularly in my main rig for my bulk storage as well. They run cool and quiet and provide a great balance between performance and long-term reliability in situations exactly like this. They have served me very well over the years, and I'm super grateful to have such an array of them set up for my primary work storage now. Installing the drives in the DS1817 Plus was super simple and toolless. Simply remove the side securing pieces from the drive bays, install your drive, being careful not to remove the rubber spacers when you do, align and replace the side securing pieces, and put them back in the drive bays. You can screw the drives in if desired, but I've generally not seen the need. The NAS also comes with keys to lock the drives in place if needed. For networking, I was in a tough spot. All of my servers and networking are kept and managed in my living room turned office in my apartment, so enterprise switches are kind of out of the question. They're far too loud to ever be a usable solution, especially since I record in here. Thankfully, Wendell from Level 1 Techs was able to refer me to a single switch that met my needs, the TP-Link Jetstream T1700G-28TQ, let's just call it Jet. Jet features 24 gigabit ports and 4 SFP Plus 10 gigabit ports, smart, unmanaged, automatic routing, and so on, and is rack mountable. And, most importantly, it's fanless. 100% silent, affordable, and features enough SFP Plus ports for me to convert all of my necessary rigs to 10 gigabit, to this day, I have yet to find another switch that checks all of these boxes. Unfortunately, the price for it is quite volatile. I wound up paying $334 when I needed to just get it, but it's back down at the time of writing to $297. Oh well, I got the switch mounted in my audio rack on my new office shelving unit above some audio interfaces, ran the SFP Plus cables to my rig and to my DS1817 over in my server rack with planned runs to a streaming PC and my fiance's rig very soon, and we're off to the races. So why am I going through all of this? Why am I not just using one of the plethora of cloud services available? To start, I'd point you to my videos on NASs and my experiences with Amazon Cloud Drive. TLDR, or TLDW I guess, NAS storage requires a high upfront cost for mass data like I use, but quickly comes out to be way more affordable than any cloud storage solution option for the kind of file sizes that I deal with. After Amazon got rid of their unlimited storage option, 2 months of only storing part of my video archive with them would cost more than this entire setup. Pretty crazy. Plus, with the Synology NAS, you get to make your own private cloud and keep things safe and secure from unwelcomed eyes while still having control to share it to the outside world. Synology's Disk Station Manager is what really seals the deal for me with this kind of setup. While obviously I'm a techie and someone who likes to get into the nuts and bolts of things, for my file storage for my business, it's one thing that I want to make sure is as stable and safe as possible, something I don't want to have to screw with too much and risk ruining things like I have before. Synology DSM takes care of all of that. Setup is always easy to follow step by step, and they make it super easy to build a storage volume. You can choose between different RAID modes for how you want to stripe your data, adjusting for how much redundancy you want versus raw capacity, speed, etc. Synology also has a sweet RAID calculator that lets you choose your NAS and expansions, drive capacities, and then see how much data is available and how much is saved for redundancy with the different types of RAIDs available before you decide, which is really neat. I'll have that linked in the video description. For my NAS, I wound up going with Synology Hybrid RAID, ButterFS with 2-disk fault protection, leaving me with a little over 57 terabytes of usable capacity left, but plenty of transfer speed and the security of knowing that I won't lose my data if something goes wrong with a disk or two, which is really important with all that I have dealt with all of this. Then you can enable NFS and set up shared folder permissions and shared folders, then mount them in Windows as a network drive or network location. Same thing on Mac or Linux. I use Windows primarily for production, so those are the steps you see here. Since sometimes I share projects across machines, I usually use the actual network location instead of mapping to a drive letter. Just makes it more compatible in case I can't map the same drive letter on every computer. Synology's software also lets you set up your own cloud drive, like a certain box of drops, where any changes made to files in the drive are synced to your other PCs, other NAS units, or mobile devices, with version tracking and recovery as well. You can also share links to specific folders or files to other people, whether they use Synology DSM or not. Really cool. I share files to my friends and people in the Discord server all the time. It's quite handy. Setup guides for everything mentioned here will be linked in the video description if you want more info, and if you want specific tutorials on this stuff, be sure to leave a comment down below and we can get making some. Those of you who have followed me for a while will have noticed that I complain substantially less about my overall storage infrastructure and back-end issues these days. I've been running this new setup for a few months now and it has been smooth sailing. Editing and rendering is faster, no longer being bottlenecked by basic gigabit speeds. File transfers are substantially quicker, meaning that I can organize and start editing quicker in the first place, and I have enough capacity, thanks to the incredible people over at WD, to keep me going for quite some time. The whole point here was to not have a new band-aid every few months. This is supposed to be a long-term thing. I'll have some follow-up videos showing how I'm condensing some of my long-term archives, as well as some additional uses and guides for Synology NASs coming in the future. For now, go check out Synology's product lineup and pick you up some WD Reds via the link in the video description down below. Hit the like button if you enjoyed. Get subscribed for more awesome tech videos where I edit them from this DS1817 Plus here. And I'll see you next time.
This video is sponsored by viewers like you.
Our videos would not be possible without the generosity of those of you who contribute to one of our fan funding options, be it DonorBox, Twitch subscriptions, direct contributions via PayPal, or Patreon. To join our inner circle and get behind-the-scenes looks at videos, go to eposvox.com/support to learn more, and join us on Discord at eposvox.com/discord. Thanks.